that provides architectural design and consultancy services for larger projects in terms of various kinds, I believe, and it's Informance. So Informance is then Mirco's professional habitat situated in Berlin these days. And so he is all over the place working on these things as much as coming here, and that is our privilege. I don't think Mirco's lecture thematically needs much of an introduction, except also, if you allow me. Mirco then, of course, represents or brings with him that sort of, you know, the knowledge and the proficiency in so-called advanced design methodology. And that goes along the lines of everything that has to do with parametricism, but also computation. And I think that all of us who think that this is important, which I would guess that most of us do without necessarily knowing what it is, we may or may not also think that it is only important insofar as it has a substantial impact, not only on the way that architecture is actually executed, I'm thinking about the design process and the fabrication and construction, but actually that which is the title of Mirco's lecture, which means that something happens up here, that basically the impact and the import of a technology and a technologically based procedure, that it actually has the potential, and perhaps more so, even that it comes with the almost a requirement, the need for us to partly change the way that we think and plan how we go about architecture today. I don't know if that's precisely what Mirco is going to speak about, but that's my fair guess.
Thanks everyone for turning up such a crowd here. Didn't expect that so early in the semester. Thanks Jan for the introduction. And I will have a couple of words on what that design thinking lecture and the planned symposium in 2 weeks' time is about. It really came from an idea I had from sitting in a jury. I think it was the first year final, end of the year jury in summer, where we had some interesting discussions. And there were some discussions about representation in architecture, diagrams in architecture, processes in architecture, and where to position yourself as a designer within these different kind of mindsets, concepts, how you want to call them. And secondly, from my kind of experience working with the APD group, because on a kind of daily basis, we try to be so contemporary, so we sometimes forget about the kind of larger framework of architecture that we and the stuff we're doing is embedded in. So design thinking lecture, I really took as an opportunity to hopefully go for some sort of a kind of roller coaster ride for the kind of history of architecture in some sort, and trying to explore kind of different mindsets that people or designers and designs kind of were governed by in history. Not only in history, but also nowadays, how it differs kind of individually from discipline to discipline, locally, and what are really the kind of the mental frameworks we all carry around that kind of shape architecture and design either consciously or subconsciously, but as designers I think we are we have the responsibility, especially in education academia, to kind of trying to be more self-aware of these things. So that's really the context, how it all started. And I think by the end of, over the summer, Jan kind of spun the idea of having a small symposium, each of the specializations. And I took that then as an opportunity to say, okay, if we have a small symposium, why not try to get three specialists that are all educated in design and that work within a high degree of specialization within the design architecture ecosystem, so to say. And in their daily jobs, they also have to interface with an array of different designers' mindsets again. So in 2 weeks' time, we have Henrik Schwantes here, who is an architectural publisher. So he published books for Saab O'Hutton, he published books for Olaf and Ilsen, for Sana. So he kind of knows quite a bit of architects. He's not an architect himself, but he is kind of in the process of bringing architecture to a larger audience, not for the artifact itself, but for a different medium. We also have Tobias Nolte, who is a consultant for Gehring Technologies, which is the technology branch of Gehring Partners. He worked with Gehring Technologies, Jean Nobel, with Zaha Hadid, with UN Studio. So he kind of interfaces, again, with different sets of architects. And we have Johannes König, who is a visual artist doing visualizations for Bloom Images. Bloom Images is a Hamburg-based visualization company doing kind of, let's say, boutique-style images for Herzog de Meuron, David Chipperfield on A. So probably you know most of the images that have been published on the Hamburg Philharmonie building, Herzog de Meuron. These are all from them. So he will talk about kind of image creation for architects. And together we will then kind of in a podium discussion kind of find out what these different mindsets and how different these mindsets in design today work and where they kind of share common ground and how do you communicate between these different mindsets. So for today, we have to go a bit into kind of, let's say, design theory. And one word of just kind of framing it, because it's called design thinking. If you kind of look up design thinking, or if you kind of heard of the term design thinking before, at the moment it is almost heavily branded by a design company, Ideo, which they use almost or sell almost as a business strategy. I will not talk about that, just that you're kind of aware of that. I think in Christian's group, one person looks into the kind of research of, I think it's Stanford University, they do the kind of design thinking. So if you look kind of into design as a kind of discipline and trying to kind of find out the kind of the mechanism that govern design, there are a couple of things that people agree on what kind of design processes are. So mainly design is about creating models and systems. Because you want to speculate on possible futures, on possible outcomes, because it is probably too costly, too risky, or ethically not thought to make any real tests. So that's why we kind of design. We have kind of a context, and we simulate that context, and then speculate for different outcomes. In order to do so, you need, first of all, empathy for the context, You need creativity in generating insights and solution, and you need some sort of rationality to kind of evaluate and analyze your solutions you generated with your creativity before. To kind of rephrase it slightly differently, or slightly kind of algorithmically or mathematically, you could say you have design variables, which are things in your design that you can, as a designer, can control. It's just kind of material often. You're fully kind of in control of the material to use, colors, to a certain degree light, all that stuff that you can actually control. Then there are context variables, which is, I don't know, maybe there's a budget, maybe there are planning constraints, and then there are performance variables. Performance variables are actually the kind of variables that that then help you to evaluate and weight the different design and context variables against each other if you have generated a solution. As a designer, you also have the possibility sometimes to change context variables to a design variable. You convince the client that you can actually spend more money than they actually budgeted in first time around. So you kind of, or you're creative with the planning. Yes. So that's the kind of that's a kind of rational model of explaining design. And to kind of summarize that, there's a kind of explorative phase in design. There's a kind of redefining phase. We're kind of trying to bring it together, synthesize it, and there's a kind of prototyping phase in design. We actually draw scenarios and see how that stuff how that could be developed further. In planning theory, there is a phrase from Horst Little, who defined design or problems in design as wicked problems. I think that's what we are facing in design. Most of the time, the problems we encounter, that are not, they are not fully defined. So they basically fall into all these categories that you don't actually know all the constraints that govern that problem from the very beginning until you have a solution. And all these other things that have known, that there's no stopping rule. So solutions, there's no right or wrong in your outcomes. There's only better or worse if you compare different outcomes. But there's no right and wrong. Every problem is unique. So there's hardly ever the case that you have kind of the same design context, the same. So kind of reusing previous solutions is never 100% possible. These are one-shot operations, so they're kind of not really repeatable. And there's no kind of alternative solution. So that most of the time really is what we are facing as designers, but it is a great opportunity because it means if the problem is a priori underdefined, we have to inject kind of meaning into that, and we have to inject kind of the framework to actually bring it to a full solution. So if we look at kind of different modes of design thinking in history, that's what we go over in the next couple of kind of slides. We'll also look over the difference in profession that people have, and we will look into kind of personal or cultural dispositions that people have. So, starting probably here, that we all, not only designers, but kind of every individual has its own view of the world, or if kind of we say in German, there's a term, Weltanschauung, which I think it's also often used in the English language because there isn't really such a kind of term available. So it's really the mental map that constitutes how you see the world. And you can encounter that sometimes in kind of just daily conversations we have with other people, not necessarily only designers, but for one person, say, everything is data. For another person, everything is communication. For one person, everything is geometry. And for another person, everything is in flux. So these are kind of just the first kind of principle. You can kind of find out that people think slightly differently, and or they have different kind of understandings of the world. And that's just kind of amongst us nowadays, that are kind of these slight differences. But there are also kind of bigger differences as kind of societies, religions, language, and what I call here epic poems. It's the kind of long tradition of kind of telling stories. Religion is part of that, but they're also kind of as the kind of Ilias, Odyssey, things that are deeply embedded over generations and generations and retold kind of stories that somehow have a certain impact, at least in some cultures. And they go also sometimes cross political borders or societal borders. And that these things are not necessarily fixed or hardwired, that's something you should also appreciate. That image here is a kind of Renaissance drawing of the human eye, and it basically shows that the human eye gives you an upside down image of the world, and what the human brain does is basically flips that back. So already on that super simple level, we're already adapting how we see the world. So there is already a lot of processing going on of making an image of the world we kind of operate in. There's also something to be said about different disciplines, how kind of designers from different disciplines, let's say an architect and an engineer, design differently, and how they approach a design problem differently. Even given the same design problem, they kind of go about it slightly differently if you carry out experiments. So an engineer or a group of engineers tries to dissect the problem into kind of smaller units and then assemble these kind of these discrete solutions into a larger whole, where an architect tries to work out already a synthesized solution in the first place, and rather goes over different options of fully synthesized solutions rather than working out individual blocks of that design. So there is a theory in linguistics, which is the sub-hypothesis, which basically says that our thinking is dramatically or partially governed by the language we use or the language we learned, because only certain terms, a certain structure exists that channels our thinking. That is a well-established theory, there's a well-established hypothesis, and it's still kind of debated how strong that is. In our very own discipline, I think it is already apparent that in English we have design, we have architecture. In the German language we have Gestaltung, we have Architektur, we have design, we have planning. And if you talk about design thinking, you wouldn't necessarily think about architecture and include architecture. Design in an architectural context in Germany often has, let's say, a slightly negative connotation. It is not capital A architecture. Design is something that is kind of shaping things up a bit, kind of making them useful, beautiful, but it doesn't come with a kind of seriousness that architecture comes with. Like in the English language, there's no such distinction. It is architectural design and has the same kind of seriousness as just talking about architecture. So these differences already in language, it's just an example of how these differences in language might lead to different kind of ways of acting. And that's just a kind of first hint how something like that is already being explored in linguistics. So I think one kind of concept we all kind of subscribe to a certain extent, or we kind of assume that as we kind of sit here, that there's some sort of evolution, even if there's some fairness here amongst us. There is some sort of, we all appreciate there is some sort of process how kind of humans evolved. That image is actually not a kind of a scientific documentation of evolution. It's by the artist Daniel Lee. You probably know from Ben's move book, kind of the cover image of that the manimal that's on there. So, although we all subscribe to, let's say, a theory of evolution, and sometimes we also use the kind of theory of evolution or some aspects of it in design, we say in evolution things come to an optimal kind of state. We sometimes oversee the limits that come with it. Because in evolution, what really matters and what happens is that the solution is only so good as your original genotype is. So if you start from a fish, yes, you can get to a human, but the human backbone is still kind of fish skeleton, which comes with its problems, so that many of us, as we kind of get older, kind of have bad back pains. It doesn't really matter so much, or it's not filtered out in evolution, because by that time we already reproduced, so people have to live with back pain kind of if they kind of hit their 40s or so. Or they exercise more and overcome that. But what I'm saying is that basically, because we all kind of come from the kind of same kind of original plan as a fish, there are limitations, and there's only so much you can do with that plan. If someone would be asked to design something like a human today, like a designer, an engineer, would probably come up with a better solution given enough time, enough information to that. So that's the kind of disadvantage of kind of evolutionary design, or kind of the concept of evolution. Although it seems to be kind of perfect, there are these kind of inherent limitations to it. You see that again in this image here. Dorothy Thompson's On Growth and Form explores that heavy, that or not only explores, but also kind of puts that idea out that we actually can look at a whole variety of fish just in terms of their kind of geometric deformations. That is not only in their shape, but also if you look actually at the bone structure, you see that the same set of bones kind of shows up in a whole set of different animals just through simple scaling operations. And obviously that's nothing new to all of us. These are things we carry around nowadays. That's one of the kind of concepts we kind of all share, either fully conscious or kind of subconscious because it came in some biology class in high school. What we are not so familiar anymore with is that things have kind of an inherent order throughout different categories. Like in classical times, like in terms of the Greeks, like Plato, there was a very clear, today we would say, a mapping between Platonic solids and the elements of the earth. So there was a Platonic solid for fire, for the sun, for water, for plants. And it was very clear to the Greeks that there was a relationship between the geometries and their meaning. And these mappings went on to the planets, to their gods. So it was creating basically a universe where everything was connected with everything, but in a very consistent manner, in their way. Because all these Platonic solids are based on proportions, and proportion was something that was basically the way how they kind of perceived the world around them, they also had a kind of very kind of precise set of proportional rules how they set out the architecture, which you see in these kind of studies of columns there, which was then later discovered by Vitruvius and Alberti, or kind of put down by them. So they actually kind of geometric relationships of proportional tiling led to a kind of understanding of the world where things kind of interconnected through their proportions. And as I said, they went on from geometry to architecture to music. They already discovered that there's some sort of harmonic tiling in music. So everything basically formed one bigger thing. You see, all these things were kind of discovered or rediscovered, I must say, in the Renaissance. And one thing that was quite striking in the Renaissance was then the discovery or rediscovery of perspective drawings, which you can see in that image here. And the kind of concept of perspective, of a kind of perspective vanishing point or vanishing points also led ultimately to a different way of architecture. You see this kind of checkerboard plaza, and this type of I won't call it just effect, but this way of thinking heavily influenced Renaissance architecture, that plazas or caves were laid out to actually enhance that type of deepness and extrusion into the space. So again, there is some technique here, actually technique how you kind of depict the world around you, or how you build an image of the world, and that image again has an influence how architecture at that point is thought through and designed. We Yeah, we sometimes think that this kind of gain of knowledge over time or in history somehow accumulates, but it's not necessarily true. We often find things kind of reoccurring, vanishing, going into the background, and it's not necessarily so that things steadily build up and you gain more knowledge. Which is very clear if you look, it's a bit blurry here, if you look at these two images, you have that image, which was a fresco in Pompeii, from coming before Christ, and this is an image, I think, from the early 1400s. So that's a kind of very real depiction of a family, which you could almost put down in the kind of 1500s. This one is an image where things like perspective don't really kind of matter, scale doesn't matter, or scale only matters as things are scaled where one part of the story is told. So it's kind of centered around a whole story that's told, an entire picture, and things like color, like the blue, color blue, the gold, the red, they have way more importance than kind of, say, a kind of true depiction of how things would look more realistic. And one could argue whether that it's kind of an advance, or whether that is really just the way how people kind of expressed what is important to them at that point and how they kind of see the world, and not kind of necessarily drawing a kind of realistic or natural realistic image of the world, but that's really how they kind of place that. So in Renaissance, as they kind of said, they kind of rediscovered the kind of the beauty of the kind of proportions they already observed in kind of Greek architecture, in a way, and we kind of redeveloped that. And one of the kind of great architects of that time was obviously Alberti, who went in kind of great length of designing these facades, and here the facade of the Palazzo Rocca in Florence, basically about these kind of proportional tilings. So when you see these tilings correspond directly to kind of harmonic proportions in music. So it's a German thing where you get the kind of septum, you get the sixth sound. That is one's that's one stand on the kind of larger frame between the columns, and then you got a different proportion on the kind of smaller frame of the actual windows. And all that is done come to a kind of harmonic kind of arrangement of the facade, but also to express a certain way of mastering these things, that you kind of express your kind of expertise in that field. So it is really kind of carefully carried out and carefully set up how these things relate. So that way of thinking, or that kind of mastery, was really kind of carried on for quite a while and went through different kind of epochs and styles from the Renaissance, and kind of it really kind of accumulated in the kind of Beaux-Arts kind of school in the kind of late 1900s or 1900s in Paris, where people really and students really had to kind of master all these proportioned ancient buildings, and the best students of that time got the kind of famous Prix de Rome. That meant they could travel to Rome on a scholarship and then draw these old things where even the kind of angle of the light was already set, so they had to be drawn with the light coming in a 45 degree angle, and they kind of assembled all the different types of drawing in this kind of amazing perspectives. But that was the kind of education at that point. Kind of going through the entire kind of history of classical architecture, kind of finding the beauty in proportions in that. And the better you could kind of move within this kind of super strict rule set, the better an architect you were. So, and that, as I said, went on almost like a little kind of accumulated over 400 years with kind of some subsets. And it kind of went on into the kind of American architecture as well. It was not a European phenomenon. Kind of similar thing was happening in North America with the kind of clay great kind of neoclassical buildings, and there, especially there, they were also finding kind of new mappings of the kind of classical proportion. So the Dorinthian column, the Dorian column, and so on, they were mapped to different types of buildings, which was kind of arbitrary, but it was kind of an expansion of the rule set. So by the early 20th century, things kind of changed into modernism. It didn't just happen like that, and you probably went into your architectural history classes, you got some kind of more thorough introduction to that. But having seen what happened for such a long time before, that was quite a radical shift that basically cut off all historic references. And I think that was the great achievement, and that's what people also fought for a very long time, cutting off this kind of preoccupations that were developed over such a long time. And obviously, as you know, modernism came from different angles. I'm just kind of putting three down here. It came from a sort of artistic abstraction, which was kind of going parallel to movements in the arts at that point. How you actually arrange things more abstract, and how you kind of draw your plans, and then come to kind of new readings through kind of these abstractions, rather than to the kind of realistic rendered drawings you saw before in the arts building. It came also from kind of new construction techniques, new materials, especially concrete, steel, and glass. So it was a kind of great advancement. So new technologies, really, and very important, also from a new social agenda. To say that architecture has to play a social role, as you see here in the Frankfurter Küche, how the kitchen workplace plays a very different role nowadays, or back then, than it was seen before. And how do you kind of organize the workplace so that it actually changes your daily life in the flat you live in, and how you can actually improve the daily life of many people. So suddenly architecture became something interested in abstraction in the arts, new materials, and a social agenda, which is something entirely different. It took obviously quite a while to kind of get used to that. And you know, in history, these things didn't happen really just at one time. It kind of slowly kind of started to take over. And obviously in modernism, Corbusier kind of came up with his kind of modulo, which again is a kind of proportional tiling based on the human figure. And we can say that kind of happened before already, because like in the Renaissance, we have seen this kind of proportions that were already related to the human figure. But I would argue there's a significant difference. Like in classical times and Renaissance, the proportions in relation to the human figure were much more to celebrate the kind of greatness of the human as the kind of pinnacle of creation in every single detail. So the church as a building overall was relative to the human proportion, then every single window and so on. It all went kind of to the tiling that fit into the human body. But it was really kind of to celebrate, and very kind of similar to what was said earlier to the mapping of the Platonic solids. It showed that everything connects with everything, and there's some greater meaning to the overall. Where in Corbusier's modulo, it was more that this gave a measure that things you interact with are actually to a kind of human scale. And it was not a representation of the human in the architecture or in buildings. It was really a guide that things have a kind of sensible scale to the human body, which is entirely different than saying it kind of represents the human at every single scale in the building design. And I think here we start to kind of see kind of big differences, and it is such a kind of great leap to kind of say the human kind of is represented at every aspect of the building, or the building is kind of scale sensitive to the human as in modernism, or as modernism tried to be. So I'd say almost parallel to modernism, developed something which is futurism, which also started off from an arts movement in Italy, where the ambition was not really to kind of to celebrate or to kind of work with new materials or to kind of find new social kind of agendas within architecture, or to work with a kind of certain abstraction. Yes, they did work along with an art movement at that point, but it was really kind of celebrating the kind of modern times that were kind of not only on the horizon, but actually the world was going through. I mean, from industrialization to the kind of great kind of through the kind of world wars. There were massive changes, and it was really finding expressions for that, and finding expressions for some sort of contemporaneous. And I would argue that kind of mindset of being kind of optimistic about the future and celebrating the future or the contemporary, and finding forms to express that, is something that was new at that point, and that continued out through into nowadays. As I put Future Systems, Lloyd's Media Center right here, I would argue it's the kind of same type of, kind of part of the same mindset, to kind of try to find kind of translations of a kind of contemporary or kind of forward-looking, optimistic way of cultural representation. And these are really representations of what one sees as being contemporary, which is very different than the modern view of saying it is an abstraction of something. This really tries to find a form and an aesthetic that is contemporary or futuristic. Like modernism, in a way, kind of accumulated to this. You hopefully all know where that is and what that is. It all came to basically the building on the left-hand side, which is Mies Seagram building, which can built in or completed in 1958. It took modernism, or really was the kind of pinnacle, I would say, of kind of modernism arriving in the US. And as kind of most of the kind of modernists moved from Europe to the US in World War II, and kind of formed a new base there, and really kind of also found the kind of backdrop to develop it to its kind of extreme or to its kind of excellent, as in the Seagram building. And I remember kind of clearly being kind of educated in Germany for first, and then also getting some, of course, being educated under professors that were kind of true modernists, kind of some sort of a postmodernist as well, but still I kind of appreciated modernism. And kind of coming to New York for the first time and seeing the Seagram building, I was like, okay, what's it all about? It's pretty boring, actually. And what is all that? You can get worked up over that detail here, but I don't really get it. But, I mean, it took a while to kind of to fully appreciate it. And yeah, it is great, but it is also such a great building in that context, as you see it there. Because at that point, the kind of whole international style is really just kicked off with that. The kind of the buildings around that look very, very different than what you see when you look at the surroundings nowadays. So at the time, it was a great building. It is still a great building because it was such a great building at that time. But as I said, these things could partially only be explained through history again. What really was the greatness back in the days? And Mies, being in the US at that point, not being a licensed architect, he worked that building together with Philip Johnson, who is one of the kind of, you know, one of the great figures in architecture. He kind of coined, branded, and went through kind of so many styles over his career, such as the building almost next door, kind of AT&T or Sony building, which then became a kind of almost the icon of postmodernism, which was obviously quite a while. It was almost kind of 30 years later to that it was completed after the Seagram building. So also they kind of placed it onto another. It took a while to kind of get into postmodernism or that kind of refinement of postmodernism. But how could that kind of happen, or what was the shift that people actually kind of went back from having achieved such a level of abstraction and having actually achieved what modernism initially started out with on the agenda of cutting historic references? As I was saying, these historic references, they don't make any sense at the moment. There are much more important things on the agenda as kind of material social agenda, and finding ways to be expressed that are more contemporary, suddenly there was a leap back in saying, we actually would like or we appreciate historic references, which you see in this kind of top of the building there. Again, just to say that kind of postmodernism, as you see here, James Stirling's poetry, one building in London against Rogers Lloyd's building. There was not an absolute, postmodernism was not an absolute style. Again, it happened in parallel with other styles and so, but postmodernism was something where they kind of appreciated a certain wittiness in design, where historic references were important, and where they kind of allowed for kind of collages in the building to happen. So there wasn't really a kind of strict rule how things were developed in kind of neoclassical terms, but they thought that there is some kind of archetypical meaning in architectural elements. So you could actually, the column, the capital and so on, there are archetypical elements which have their place, and they were rejected for kind of the wrong reasons. And it makes it, and the human is kind of trained and used to kind of read these elements, and it gives them kind of security, confidence, and pleasure to kind of appreciate these architectural artifacts and not being confronted with the kind of plainness of kind of modern architecture that doesn't really kind of give any of that. So again, it is a kind of shift in architecture, and probably the kind of biggest shift is that suddenly architects were playing on this kind of wittiness or playfulness that design could happen, and it wasn't really so serious anymore, or they took the wittiness serious in a way. Yeah, Rogers building here, I would argue again that probably sits on it takes material and building technology aspect of modernism, but also has this kind of futuristic, forward-looking, optimistic way of finding a representation of modern times. So how kind of entangled things seem to be, or are actually, it's a question here, is to be seen here in the diagram from Charles Jenks, which he drew for the first time in the early 70s or mid-70s, where he really tried to map out architectural styles, movements, and buildings in a kind of big master diagram. And he kind of placed scale on the left-hand side, which goes from idealistic, self-conscious, intuitive, activist, kind of environmental, and kind of plots that against the time, and you see this kind of white clouds where things don't really touch, and then you see this kind of clusters. You have modernism, you have the Amsterdam School, you have expressionist, you have Le Corbusier, is actually, I mean, some things are really questionable in there, but it's a great effort, and I think it is a great artifact of that time, because it really shows the kind of the way how people with in early postmodernism start things seeing happening parallel to each other, and that it is actually not such a big deal to kind of follow one trend through, but there is this kind of great variety, and things are all kind of relative to each other. And this is kind of great equalness within that map. So it kind of just puts things out, and it isn't really that difficult to move one from one place to the other. So it's all kind of, I would say, collage together, and you don't see this kind of great continuity in history. So in that sense, it is also liberating, and I think that kind of liberation swings in postmodernism quite a bit. That suddenly you don't, I mean, yes, modernism happened to kind of cut off many of the historic references, but then in itself it became quite a strong framework again, where people kind of felt trapped, and actually that diagram in a way shows the kind of richness that is actually available to designers. And then it's more choice where you actually position yourself within that. It's not so easy to change from one place to the other, but in itself it shows the great priority of that, say again, design ecosystem. So. So at the kind of similar kind of time in the 70s, when kind of, what I said, kind of first postmodern buildings kind of that made historic references, we kind of fought out kind of in America, Chumi and Eisenman made the kind of first experiments, which went in quite a different direction, which were more kind of focused on kind of abstract readings, diagrams, in Chumi's kind of Manhattan transcripts, taking events in the city through different media like film, then finding notations for that and trying to work these notations into some urban and architectural proposal. So it really became something that is already kind of process driven, that starts from a very abstract reading, a very individual reading, but then following through a kind of rigorous set of rules that might be very specific and unique to an individual, but it tries to develop an inherent logic that is then carried out over a project. Similar to Eisenman, which is with his kind of nine square problem, taking almost a kind of a Vitruvian kind of problem of arranging the plan of villas, kind of almost flipping that or working that to an extreme, that the kind of juxtaposition of different plans actually gave new readings of that quite rigid framework of kind of classical architecture. So suddenly these things kind of are also a kind of response to modernism, where people kind of thought they were kind of trapped in. So you have these kind of, yeah, these abstractions which aim at a certain complexity and ambiguity that leave room for interpretation through many the kind of juxtaposition of graphics. On the other hand, kind of if you kind of pursue the kind of postmodern way of thinking, it didn't really stop some kind of extreme thinkers at kind of collaging historic artifacts, but really building iconographic buildings down to one single historic reference and finding a new and, again, kind of witty interpretation of an historic artifact. So the pyramid in the Louvre, it's kind of it's the archetype of a classical pyramid. It's not solid, it's in glass, and on top of that there is a second pyramid, kind of inverted, top down, facing into the atrium. So it kind of goes over the kind of traditional readings and kind of injects a new kind of interpretation of this kind of classical readings into that. Similar, the kind of great the Grand Arch from Spreckelsen in Paris, which is a very simple form, and then if you see here, it is, if you see how the form kind of sits on the ground, it's actually rotated by six degrees. So that again shows some sort of playfulness in there, that you kind of do these kind of simple movements to give it this kind of twist, similar to kind of putting the pyramid upside down. So you kind of rely on these kind of historic references, but then you kind of show that it just kind of is just this slightly bit off. Although with the Grand Arch, I think one must say that, or now it is argued that it's only down to kind of infrastructural planning, that there was no other way to place that beast because of the foundation there. But again, that is, these two designs, they're kind of so typical for that point in time, because of their kind of strong representational character. They make such a clear reference to the pyramid and the arch, like the facing the Arch of Triumph on the other side of the axis. And that isn't necessarily the only way or the only solution to such a problem. You kind of see in a kind of backward-looking and forward-looking example here that you have the arch in St. Louis from Sarinen, which was built almost like 25 years before the Grand Arch in Paris, which has a different scale, but again, it didn't even try to make any historic references. It is almost like a mixture between a kind of sculpture and a piece of engineering. Its form is entirely driven by the structural means. It's the form against the cross section, and that really kind of gives that arch its kind of expression. And on the other hand, you have Rams CCTV building, which is interesting to see that he didn't make any historic references here. That's a kind of complete new type of building, but again, on an image, it is actually very similar to the Spreckelsen building in Paris, which Rem would kind of probably greatly have tried to not to make any references to. But what I'm trying to say here is that although from kind of a recipient point of view, these buildings might have something in common, they're kind of so entirely different in the kind of thinking, attitude, and context they were developed in. Just going back to Paris, to these two buildings we've seen there, at the same time these two buildings were kind of completed, there was the competition for the Parc de la Villette, and there were two entries that were fairly similar at that point. They were fairly similar at that point in terms of their thinking and and methodology. There was Chumi's, oh good, you don't see the labels here because I just see I flipped them. there's OMA's proposal on the left-hand side, which is a juxtaposition of different layers, where each layer either is just kind of lines on the ground, different tiles on the ground, different materials. There's grass, then there are different programs, there are axes, and they're kind of developed almost independently, and through juxtaposing these layers, the design kind of creates an intense richness. A similar approach, almost an equal approach, is taken by Werner Chumi here, where I think the only thing that is different is that he actually develops already kind of elements, which are kind of building elements at the very top, and these kind of gridded, these gridded follies that sit there, which are not articulated in that plan, and there's a kind of groundscape, and these things kind of juxtapose and intersect and create what they both were hoping for, kind of new moments at points of intersection. So suddenly you have this kind of concept which started probably like 8 years, 10 years earlier, of kind of juxtaposing kind of diagrams, collaging diagrams, that then made it into kind of grand designs, landing kind of big prizes and competitions. So again, that was not an absolute movement. Another response to kind of modernism was suddenly the appreciation or the intense work on a conceptual level, which really came from, again, looking at how things developed in art, not necessarily in contemporary art, but maybe in art that was kind of initiated 15, 20 years before. And so Herzog de Meuron, I think with the first Ricola building they did, where they were neither making any historical references, nor were they kind of following kind of modernist kind of rules of kind of pure kind of function and so, but they really developed their own concept and story, how that kind of building becomes a kind of response to the client's needs, but also develops something that is so unique for the building and also that gives them the kind of framework to argue the building through, because that's what it really, what these concepts are, is that other than in postmodernism, where people really try to find forms in kind of historic references, here they were trying to develop a concept which really guided them through the development and design of the building. So in the Ricola building, it works with these kind of concrete faces. It has the semi-translucent facade, which has a plant print on the facade, which is a reference to the herbs they're using for the candy that's made in there. And the concrete facade, again, is designed in a way that the water just rinses down the facade, so that over time you get algae and all sorts of kind of aging on the facade, which again brings a connection to the kind of to the natural sources that are put into the kind of herbs, candy they kind of fabricating in that building. So it, you see, it's kind of embedded in a concept, which at that time is also something new that you work kind of conceptually almost as an artist does. I think Dillard's Cathedral building, it's quite some time later, it's almost kind of 15, 20 years later, but it's kind of sitting in exactly the same kind of school of thinking, that you kind of employ conceptual thinking, you develop something that is helping you to kind of develop the building, not in a formal way, not in a functional way, but really around some values you establish as you set out the design or your own brief for the design. I would say the a kind of continuation or a kind of branch, a sub-branch of conceptual thinking that developed was then the kind of work with diagrams. And you could also argue that the kind of views we've seen for the park Viet entries from Chumi and OMA were already a kind of diagramming. It happened more so than, as you see here, the diagrams they were getting more spatially and not just a kind of juxtaposition of graphics. Where in the kind of when in the Parc de Villette entries, we've seen that the juxtaposition of graphics were actually planned graphics where each layer already had a meaning and they were already to scale. They were just juxtaposed, and then at true scale things kind of collided. Where in these abstract machines, how they would also be called, these types of diagrams, they were not to scale. They were giving an entirely different kind of framework to guide you through design than these concepts we've just seen before. So it was giving you some sort of spatial reading, but it was not not formally fixed how that how these spaces are then interpreted. And as you see here, how one translates into the VPRO building from MVRDV, and the other one translates into the Yokohama Ferry Terminal. And actually, both buildings and both models you've seen before, they don't necessarily match in scale and expression detailing how the actual building looks in the end. But it gave the designers really the kind of backdrop and framework to develop the design through all the way. I think that's really crucial. And it really was the kind of first wave of kind of folding in architecture. I think at that point, I think it was 92 or so, there was an AD issue, which is kind of folding in architecture. It is good to kind of look at, or look back at once in a while, because we're still kind of dealing with these things, but I think it's good to look back because back then, these things were initiated from a very different kind of starting point. As you see here, we still deal with folding nowadays. It might be called folding, but it is entirely different from kind of Vanhoefer, Lord, and Nicholas. The Hinsett Museum, it's developed out of a foldable, of a kind of folded structure. It is kind of folding on two scales, on a kind of more global scale, it's kind of folded, and then on a smaller scale, you also get this tessellation. It's kind of steel on the corrugated steel on the outside, and a timber structure on the timber cladding on the inside. And you see that this kind of folding is so entirely different than the folding we had before, because it is what it is. It operates almost on a one-to-one scale. The folding is already worked out in the kind of steel plates, and the kind of the smaller scale folding is in relation to the kind of larger scale folds. So there is kind of scale proportional relation between the different folds, which is entirely different than the kind of programmatic folds we've seen in the buildings 15, 18 years ago. But still, seeing the kind of same concept behind it, but this time I would say they're more about processes. It's really kind of looking at the process of folding rather than looking at the kind of concept of folding. Because here you really try out the material rather than trying out how strongly that concept of folding carries you through also all different scales and also through different applications from material to program and so on. Here it really is what it is. And kind of showing to different ways of kind of process thinking. We've all seen kind of Greg's Alesi vases, although it's a bit unfair putting in here. I think it's the only kind of industrial design piece in the presentation. It's not really at architectural scale, but it kind of draws a reference to Greg's work, which developed initially out of animation. So taking an inspiration from kind of processes that are digital, and in this instance, taking two other references. One reference is the process that gives you the kind of surface texture of the router bit that goes into milling out the form or the kind of negative for this T-set, and the process of explosion molding these titanium sheets into the form. So it's kind of a triple process that kind of goes into that artifact. Again, which is entirely different than creating a form and then thinking through the material. Really, that is thought from the kind of design initiation to fabrication to surface articulation, that is all interconnected into one process. similar here, the kind of facade of shops, brick building, which kind of builds up an entire chain of kind of design, fabrication, installation, and occupation through this kind of brick facade. It's kind of trying to set up an entirely new construction method and kind of delivery method on site. So that is kind of entirely, or not entirely, but that is trying to be kind of as process driven on an architectural scale as that is process driven on a industrial design scale. So, and I couldn't help myself kind of going through lecture without mentioning the performance. Again, that is not something to kind of advocate as an absolute, but again, it just shows that as you kind of look at kind of design under performative aspects, it shifts perspective greatly. What I find is interesting, if you forget about the kind of the engineering of that for a moment. If we look back what was stated in the very beginning, that your design kind of is set up by the kind of design parameters, by the context parameters, and by the performative parameters, I think performance is much more than just kind of engineering-like images. Performance really is a tool that helps you to kind of assess and talk critically about your design, which again is then more mindset than just the kind of tool set, which this in effect is. So coming to a conclusion here is kind of putting up three images. You probably know most of the building, if not, it doesn't really matter. That's a building, and on the left-hand side, it's a building. Lan is the central point building, which has a kind of exoskeleton, kind of concrete facade. One of the great modernist buildings in London. That's Barco-Leibinger's building, and that's the Koop-Himmelblau buildings in Dayan, which just opened. And what I think is interesting about these images, and as a conclusion, there is that we nowadays look at them with a kind of contemporary view, and suddenly things like the building on the left-hand side, if we see that in context with these other two buildings, we could already start, or we as designers, we already start seeing the possible variations that could happen within a kind of facade like that, or we could see the kind of precision that could happen in a facade like that. So by kind of reading things from kind of contemporary view into kind of historic references, that could also kind of help to kind of enrich or kind of refocus our own mindset critically. So the conclusion really is that then these different mindsets a designer employs are mainly a kind of device of communication. It's a kind of device of communicating with your design, kind of helping you to carry through designing, but also communicating to other architects in school, to kind of to a jury, to clients, and to kind of convince people of kind of believing in the kind of given design. What's so great about it is that other than kind of language, which we are all kind of embedded in, it is its kind of own language and its kind of own mindset. And as a designer, you're very much in control of kind of shaping that mindset and that device of communication. Other than the language we all use, we can also use kind of the language we have more creatively or rhetorically skillful, but we don't have that malleability in the language as we have in the kind of design thinking that's around us. So I think as important as kind of designing, it is as important kind of reformulating and developing the actual design thinking. Thank you very much. So,
many questions.
There should be many. No pressure. Yep. Yes. Yeah, I think it's certainly so that the kind of the balance between the three varies greatly between the kind of different kind of mindsets in design thinking, I kind of showed. But it could also then vary within within one mindset. If, let's say, even if you're kind of design process driven, a specific design task might be more kind of heavy on the context variables, or you'll be able to turn context variables into design variables. So that's the kind of control you gain as a designer. And I think there is no absolute value, or there's no way of mapping the kind of balance of variables to different ways of thinking about design. I think that is kind of independent. It just shows, just tries to establish a model of what design is governed by, or how you could talk in a kind of rational way about what design is. And that's where the variable model helps. It happens, yeah, things are a bit more complex, but also happens often in real world that the context is probably the only thing that's there, and then design variables are going to be established as you go along. So there is, especially what you experience in an academic context, the kind of brief writing also happens in real world, that briefs are often underdefined, that you don't really have all the necessary kind of directions in the beginning. It's like, okay, what? How do you actually want to live in that building? What type of corporation do you want to run there? Although there's a corporation that will take over that building, but for some reason they kind of go into a new building, or they kind of build a new building. So there is some change to come. How much change they kind of are happy to handle, and so on. These are things that you can. You have to find out whether that's a given context or whether that is something that is up for grabs and to develop into the design. And just to be clear about that, the kind of performance variable really is just a just an expression for evaluating your design. It is not about performative design as we kind of know it in APD. So it kind of applies to every single designer, that at some point you argue for your design and you have to kind of argue for why that choice of color is good or kind of worse than another choice of color, that type of performance, and how heavy that choice is balanced against the choice of material you have. That's the kind of.
I'm wondering, what do you think about the ego of the designer, the concept designer? Is it, and what are the possible architects who work for someone in relation to the other project and then also to the inhabitants? And is that something that you see in the evolution concept?
You see the ego?
The ego, yes. Yeah. Like, the person who's designing thinks that they're designing the best thing. And it's always a juxtaposition of like, the standard.
It is, but it's. I think it's then. It's on two levels, probably. It's like what drives a designer forward, and some are driven by ego, that they are driven by getting stuff out there, and others are driven by sheer size. That things have to be kind of big, that kind of triggers the ego, and others have to be kind of have to be appreciated in a certain.
So if you're more inclined towards the art world rather than a kind of technology world, then you're trying to make moves to shine there. It is difficult to say how much that plays a role. If there's an assumption that it always plays a role to be real. I think if you you kind of need designers to have, you need all sorts of egos. And some are carrying more kind of outputs and others are kind of playing a more smart way.
I'm wondering whether it has a more dominant role lately, for example, when we see projects more like the last one that we're seeing, where it's much more sort of parametrically orientated design process.
Answering that without having even touched it in the talk here, I think lately I have had the observation that the kind of big egos are actually attracting. And it is really true, actually, things like parametric design, you want to call it, there is a way more distributed way of doing things. And also a way more distributed way of doing design, rather than kind of sketching out things that are then kind of executed on us. It is, and I'm really positive about that. It is more open than years ago for kind of intervening on all sorts of level into that design. And I think also the kind of the big egos appreciating that. They all mention the teams nowadays. And it's not just talk, I would say. They know that they're dinosaurs. I would say. And if you look at kind of emerging egos, there are not so many around in the last 10 years. For various reasons. But I think they all contribute to the fact that it is more it's a more distributed model of design.
Maybe that was just a big break with the traditions to be sort of like this. And I really appreciate the the broad and very historical account of different forms of design thinking. But I also get the sense that there are some, I mean, one thing is to speak, to have, I mean, I would quite like to piece together, for instance, design thinking when speaking to a client, as you touched upon. And design thinking, as you set out at the beginning, is a series of different ways to describe it. And it was fantastic to see it. I know the description of design thinking myself, but I believe originated with, I think it's in the right, Chalmers. That were reiterated by or appropriated by an American management theorist, Eugene Lidker. And it basically goes along five points. One is the cycles of hypothesis driven, aspect exploratory. One of my favorites is conjecture and value driven. Is that four or five? I can't remember the last one. But it seems to me that would be more to describe a sort of operation, or describe a shop talk, or describe the actual process of exploring, in this case, architectural design possibilities, as was the examples of results of behind you. And isn't that very different than a design thinking as a design outlook and how you bring it to
Yeah, I think the